Mexican. No one loves life more than we do, in a way, because we are so conscious about death.
Chilaquiles, carne asada, enchiladas, taquitos, flautas, sopes, lonches, gringas. Pase, amiga, siéntese, estamos aquí para servirle.
Distinguidos participantes, estudiantes, docentes, funcionarias y funcionarios de Jalisco, México y el mundo. Me complace darles la más cordial de las bienvenidas a la Cumbre de Ciencias de la Ciudad 2020 que organizamos conjuntamente la Universidad de Guadalajara y el Instituto Tecnológico de Massachusetts. La crisis sanitaria global provocada por el COVID-19 ha obligado a la humanidad entera a cambiar y a modificar muchos de los planes que se habían establecido para este año, y este evento no fue la excepción. Originalmente esperábamos recibirlos en persona en Guadalajara, una ciudad vibrante e innovadora, la segunda más grande de México con casi 5 millones de habitantes y 9 municipios que conforman su área metropolitana. No obstante, gracias a la tecnología, la creatividad y el trabajo de muchas personas en ambas instituciones organizadoras, la Cumbre de Ciencias de la Ciudad 2020 llega hasta ustedes en la modalidad a distancia. Desde el 2017, en la Universidad de Guadalajara, formamos parte de la red de laboratorios de ciencias de la ciudad lideradas por el MIT. En este contexto, nos llena de orgullo que nuestra ciudad y la Universidad de Guadalajara sean la cuarta sede de este encuentro internacional, como lo fue Andorra la Bella en 2017, Shanghái en 2018 y Hamburgo en 2019. Power of Without no es solo el título de la cumbre, es una frase que nos evoca a la búsqueda de soluciones innovadoras y de iniciativas que involucren a la comunidad y a sus instituciones. Las ciudades se erigen como enormes paradojas donde se concentran la innovación, la cultura, los servicios y el crecimiento económico, pero por otro lado, producen pobreza, criminalidad y crisis social. Lamentablemente, esta riqueza y poder cultural no se distribuye siempre equitativamente. Con este espíritu de trabajo, les damos a todas y a todos la más cordial bienvenida y en particular a nuestros socios de la red de laboratorios. Finalmente, los invito a visitar el pabellón de la realidad virtual de la Universidad de Guadalajara en la página oficial del evento, en la que podrán conocer un poco más de nuestra institución, espacios y proyectos de investigación. Muchas gracias a todos los participantes por su asistencia a este encuentro. Estoy seguro que las jornadas de trabajo serán muy productivas y fortalecerán la colaboración internacional de la red para el estudio de las ciudades. Bienvenidos y muchas gracias.
Hablar sobre el futuro de las ciudades es hablar sobre el futuro del mundo. Me da mucho gusto que por primera vez una ciudad de América Latina sea la sede de la Cumbre Mundial de Ciencias de la Ciudad que organiza el MIT. Me da además más gusto que la Universidad de Guadalajara sea parte de este gran esfuerzo por discutir el futuro de las ciudades, particularmente en el caso de América Latina. Estamos seguros que la experiencia que se ha generado en nuestra ciudad para generar gobernanza metropolitana, para crear nuevas instituciones que le den viabilidad a la ciudad que nos imaginamos todos, pueda ser también un espacio y una oportunidad de reflexión sobre la agenda de trabajo que tenemos en el futuro. Es para mí un gran honor poder acompañar este enorme esfuerzo, ser parte de un ejercicio de reflexión en una institución tan prestigiada a escala global como es el MIT, y por supuesto que la Universidad de todos los Jaliscienses esté acompañando este proceso, sea la sede de este espacio de reflexión que sin duda nos va a aportar muchas experiencias, que nos va a traer nuevas ideas de cómo podemos construir ciudades que verdaderamente pongan a la gente en el centro de atención, que mejoren la calidad de vida de las personas y que sobre todo sean ciudades que entiendan la importancia de poner el medio ambiente y la agenda de la justicia social, en el centro de atención de la acción pública. Les mando un abrazo desde Casa Jalisco, mucho éxito en este ejercicio y que la gente que va a acompañar las transmisiones a través de las redes disfruten de un espacio de análisis y de discusión que incorporará a personas de gran experiencia a nivel mundial y que sin duda aportará, insisto, una agenda de trabajo para desarrollar en el futuro en las ciudades de México, de América Latina y del mundo.
Hello, I'm Kent Larson, director of the City Science Group at the MIT Media Lab. Welcome to our fourth annual City Science Summit hosted virtually by the University of Guadalajara. The theme of this summit is the power of without. Now, what does that mean, the power of without? Well, we're imagining a world without centralized, sometimes destructive systems, but with the new, usually lightweight, distributed, responsive, often co-created systems. You'll hear about many of these over the next 3 days. We usually resist framing our work in the negative. After all, without is the absence of something. But I have found that this often helps people let go of their preconceptions, to embrace new opportunities, to think beyond the conventional and increasingly obsolete hierarchical models that we often take for granted. It can communicate a sense of urgency and a need to take action. About the negative, rather than being multidisciplinary, we often speak of our research as being anti-disciplinary. We want to actively break down the artificial boundaries between disciplines, because innovation typically occurs not at the center of a domain, but rather at the intersection of multiple domains. We want engineers to think like designers. We want social scientists to embrace computer science. Likewise, in today's world, it is not enough to just be accepting of other races. We need to be anti-racist, which means actively working to eliminate racism from society. Now, we started thinking about the power of without a few years ago by focusing on emerging technology that could transform slums and informal settlements some point in the future, places where up to 3.5 billion people are not likely to have access to conventional infrastructure in their communities. We imagined a future of power without grids, sanitation without sewers, water without pipes, food without soil. We prepared a taxonomy of settlement types and a database of emerging technologies that might realize this vision. We then began to apply this thinking to address what I consider to be the major challenge of cities. That is, the settlement patterns that promote long-distance commuting, traffic congestion, wasted resources, pollution, and vast inequalities. One possibility that I'm very excited about is what might be called order without zoning. This is where algorithmic land use regulations replace static regulations and provide dynamic incentives for landowners and real estate developers to create diverse and affordable housing that is in sync with local jobs, and to create walkable access to all of the resources one needs in life, that is shopping, healthcare, recreation, cultural venues, etc. If we can harness market forces through creative public policy, we could achieve a kind of civic homeostasis, which is a community in harmony, much like a natural ecosystem. This could, over time, dramatically reduce energy consumption and simultaneously increase public health, equity, and safety. Now, we're beginning to see hints of a profound transformation, perhaps a trend towards a form of cities without. Cities all over the world are rapidly transitioning to streets without cars. This is Little Italy in Manhattan, where cars are banned and streets became places for people rather than machines. Related to this, cities all over the world are accelerating their plans to provide mobility without cars. Almost overnight, pop-up bike lanes have replaced car lanes, and some cities have largely implemented their 10-year bike infrastructure plan in just the last 6 months. The logical next step towards mobility without cars would be lightweight autonomous mobility modes that provide the convenience of rideshare with bike-like vehicles that come to you on demand, such as our prototype of the persuasive electric vehicle, or an even lighter autonomous bicycle. So I'm so pleased that the researchers in our City Science Network have taken the power of without concept in new and exciting directions, focusing not just on infrastructure and technology, but also design and public policy that can address social issues. Today, during the main stage event, you will hear talks ranging from Mexico without crime, to citizen safety without violence, to data without surveillance. And this will be followed by 3 days of workshops to explore in much greater detail concepts such as equity without zoning, campuses without walls, governance without bureaucrats. So thank you all for helping us explore new and creative possibilities that might help address these challenges to help us explore the power of without.
Hola, buenas tardes.
Hi everyone, nice to have you here.
El día de hoy estamos aquí para presentarles a los ponentes que nos acompañan en la segunda sección de este summit, en lo que llamamos la serie de Lightning Talks, unas presentaciones muy cortas de 4 minutos en donde pretendemos presentarles grandes ideas.
This first section will give us a foundation in the power of without, and it will let you know what some of our speakers are thinking of as their vision of how we take this forward in our research. The first speaker today is Lord Norman Foster. If you attended our last summit, you'll remember that he was the keynote speaker there. There he discussed the future of rapidly urbanizing cities. He's in conversation with our director, Kent Larson. They'll discuss the future of architecture and how it can play out in the next coming years.
Nos acompañará también la arquitecta mexicana Frida Escobedo. Ella hablará sobre los aspectos invisibles de la arquitectura y qué tiene que ver con la labor doméstica. Tendremos también al arquitecto y urbanista brasileño Vinicius Netto, quien nos platicará sobre los temas del orden y el desorden y también la segregación urbana. Nos acompaña también Dina Buchbinder, quien tratará su visión de la educación de los niños a través del juego. También el doctor Eduardo Santana, nuestro director del Museo de Ciencias Ambientales en Guadalajara, hablará sobre el aprovechamiento de los museos como instituciones educativas que inspiran la curiosidad. Y finalmente, tendremos al doctor Eduardo López Moreno, director de ONU Habitat en México, quien resaltará la importancia de transitar hacia ciudades sin desigualdad.
Enjoy the first section. We'll see you soon.
I'm here with Lord Norman Foster, who built one of the great architecture and engineering firms, Foster and Partners, as well as the Norman Foster Foundation. So, Norman, perhaps we can start with some of the issues facing us today by looking back in time. You started your practice in the 1960s at a time when young people were focused on the war in Vietnam, civil rights, women's rights, and the environment. What did you learn from that time that might be relevant to us today?
Kent, the period that you're talking about was also significant in two other respects. It was the Cold War. You really did not know whether you were going to wake up in the morning. You know, the world could be annihilated. I mean, we lived with that, and it's very easy to forget it. It was also the birth of what we now call the Green Movement. It hadn't been called that then, but you had writers like Rachel Carson, Silent Spring, talking about the chemicals that could destroy the biosphere. You had Buckminster Fuller with his Guide to Spaceship Earth. So it was the two opposites the optimism about the future of the planet, but the warning signs about its fragility, and also the imminent threat. So there are parallels.
Well, let's talk about cities. Many people are speculating about what cities will be in the future. And looking at articles in the press, they seem to fall into three general camps. So one, some people think the cities are obsolete. If you can work anywhere, you can live anywhere, why do we need cities? Second camp argues that once we have the vaccine and immunity, everything will quickly go back to normal. And a third camp says that all of the fragilities and inequities that have been revealed by the pandemic will prompt us to make cities more resilient and vibrant. So what do you think the future of cities will be?
I think I'm coming from a fourth camp, which is closer to your last category. The trends which were already apparent will be accelerated, will be magnified. Mm-hmm. And the story of cities is the story of crises. I mean, the cholera outbreak, which killed thousands in London, technology came to the rescue in terms of sanitation, modern sanitation as we know it. The Thames as a river was an open sewer. It was also an opportunity to create some beautiful elements of London that we take for granted today, the Thames embankment, underground public transport. All of these were spawned by that. So if that was London in the middle of the 19th century, it could be Chicago with the Great Fire, which heralded fireproof construction, high rise. It could be the earthquake of Lisbon, which ushered in anti-seismic structures. It could be the Great Fire of London, which set the DNA of London as we know it. I mean, the Victoria, you know, the Georgian terrace, the brick party walls, the recess windows. So the story of cities is a story of crises and of rebirth and regeneration.
So what positive things do you see happening today that may be the direct result of the pandemic?
Go to Soho now. I mean, entire streets are no longer for traffic, they're for people.
Yeah, I'm aware of a city in Europe that finished their 10-year plan to transform streets for cars into streets for bikes and pedestrians just this year.
It's incredible. I mean, the predicted growth of the e-bike was 3 years. That growth of 3 years has happened in 3 months.
Well, the theme of this summit, as you know, is the power of without, imagining a world without increasingly obsolete centralized infrastructure and with more lightweight responsive systems, ideas that you and I have talked about at length. How can these concepts address the great long-term challenge of our era, which is climate change?
You can't address climate change without concerted, unified global action. But you can make a lot of things locally and avoid a lot of the blockages of the big supply chains. Whether that's drugs that are made in one country or flowers which are grown in another country. So I think this tendency to be able to have sanitation without sewers, to have power without power stations or power lines, to have meat without animals, to have produce without soil. Again, all of these tendencies are here. With time, they'll be magnified. They will be taken for granted in a way that we take so many things for granted, which didn't exist in terms of our grandparents.
So, Norman, thank you. It's been a great pleasure. Thank you for joining us at this City Science Summit, Guadalajara.
Muy contenta de estar aquí. La historia larga un poco más corta. Tengo una oficina en la Ciudad de México y hacemos arquitectura, pero también diseño y arte. Entonces hemos estado siempre como en esta periferia de la arquitectura, en donde no es simplemente arquitectura tradicional, aunque sí lo hacemos. Y también nos gusta mucho hacer investigación. A mí me ha gustado como dar clases porque siento que aprendo más de lo que enseño. Y justo este tema que empezó con arquitectura tradicional, con una comisión de una casa en específico que ahora les puedo mostrar, de estos proyectos que son como difusos y que van tomando como diferentes ramificaciones, pero que al final del día regresan a la arquitectura, ¿no? A la práctica. Hablábamos mucho del sin visibilización, ¿no? O sea, sin que sea evidente esta idea como de cosas que suceden aunque no las percibimos y cómo la arquitectura es un poco cómplice de ese proceso de invisibilizar ciertas dinámicas sociales. Hace un año salió la película esta de Alfonso de Cuarón, La Roma. Y bueno, parte importante de la película es la arquitectura del espacio, ¿no? Esta es la reconstrucción a partir de lo que vemos en escena. Y como podemos ver, pues en la parte superior hay este pequeño volumen, como afuera de la casa, donde está este cuarto de la trabajadora doméstica, que está dentro de la vida de la casa, pero al mismo tiempo como en esta tensión de atracción y de distanciamiento que suceden en estas relaciones que son familiares, pero que también son sociales y económicas. Y que bueno, todo empezó cuando nos comisionaron este proyecto de Ordo 100 en Mongolia. Parte del programa tenía dos cocinas, de la cocina húmeda y la cocina seca. Una cocina en donde realmente se preparaban los alimentos y otra que servía como para display y recibir a la gente. Es algo que trasciende geografías. Entonces un poco era como pensar en una casa que sí es la que realmente es el corazón y el motor de la vivienda. Y la que estaba alrededor, que era una vivienda de fin de semana, pues más bien funcionaba como un pabellón mucho más ligero, a revisar que ese tipo de arquitecturas pues se daban en muchos lugares. Y que en México está así muy amarrado al tema de género y al tema de raza y de etnia, ¿no? Se piensa que en realidad lo que debería suceder es que el trabajo doméstico pagado debería de desaparecer. Pero ¿por qué no, en lugar de pensar que lo tenemos que eliminar, es pensar que lo tenemos que dignificar? Es que lo que se tendría que eliminar son los sistemas de discriminación, ¿no? Y las barreras que excluyen a una parte y dejan en posición de poder a la otra. Y eso otra vez sucede como en diferentes escalas. Entonces, siento que entre más podamos ser capaces de vivir con los otros y poder reconocerlos y hacerlos visibles y compartir de manera digna nuestras labores y reconocerlas como una actividad fundamental, pues entonces podremos llegar como a un balance como un poco más justo. Forzados a estar en nuestras casas en esta pandemia, sí nos hemos dado cuenta de lo imprácticos que se vuelven nuestros propios espacios domésticos, de lo innecesario que son muchas de las áreas que tenemos en casa, que ahora sí nos estamos haciendo responsables de producir nuestra comida y desechar nuestros desperdicios, que eran como dos partes de la ecuación que nos estábamos saltando. Bueno, o sea, ojalá esto como que nos lleve a tener una relación como mucho más consciente del valor del trabajo doméstico. Eso nos hará como pagar salarios más dignos, que haya seguro social para las trabajadoras y trabajadores domésticos, reconocer que también tienen que tener tiempos para su propia maternidad y para el propio cuidado de sus enfermos y de sus ancianos. Había una frase del Sindicato Nacional de Trabajadoras del Hogar que era redistribuir, lo cual quiere decir que la esfera masculina se tiene que involucrar más en el tema de los cuidados, reconocer el trabajo de las personas que lo están haciendo de manera remunerada o sin remunerarse y reducir. O sea, de pronto decimos, bueno, necesitamos todos estos espacios. Y lo mismo con los platos, ¿no? El platito, el pan, el de la ensalada, el vaso, el vasito, el vasote. A lo mejor no necesitamos tanto para vivir mejor y tener más mejores relaciones interpersonales. En 2015, el trabajo doméstico no remunerado, ese que hacen las amas de casa, estuvo valorado en 21% del Producto Interno Bruto de México. Entonces, quiere decir que las mujeres están subsidiando gran parte de la economía nacional y que por eso están también limitadas en muchas de sus derechos. No tienen acceso a servicios de salud, no tienen un derecho a un retiro, ellas siguen trabajando todo el año. Creo que la clave está como en las redes de solidaridad, ¿no? O sea, cuando hay grupos de personas que están en una situación de desventaja, lo que las fortalece más es compartir esas historias y poder otra vez como hacer un grupo que logre más cosas, ¿no? En la individualidad es muy difícil lograr nada, ¿no?
So, what elements make up the urban fabric? The answer depends on your concepts. You can think in terms of layers, you can think in terms of networks, you can think about different materialities. The usual answer is about the physical form and components of the city, the tangible objects like buildings and blocks, which you can see and you can touch. But even the physical dimension of the urban fabric is tricky, because we walk through voids between walls. We walk between tangible objects and surfaces that define urban blocks, for instance, and buildings. So space is also the voids, is also continuous, and we navigate through it. And it is structured as a system, with the streets, we walk in the corridors and rooms where we live. The urban fabric contains other elements which are created by our minds and our actions, like meanings and activities and social contexts that we perform in space. Something we can call semantic information, which we enact in buildings and places. The idea of information as part of the urban fabric therefore opens up possibilities. We can use this information in our lives and actions. This information cuts across different materialities of space. So the built environment contains information, and different built environments contain different amounts of information. One way of understanding this is through a measure of entropy. Entropy is essentially a property of how unpredictable a system is. And this has to do with disorder. Disordered structures are highly unpredictable. So you can understand information in space by looking into how much order and predictability you can find in the built environment around you. We developed a measure to assess order in the built environment by counting the frequency of different combinations of cells of built form. High frequencies of particular combinations increase order. So we are likely to find higher amounts of order in cities and spatial cultures with strong top-down systemic planning. That is, planning which takes ensembles of buildings into account. We also managed to find a relation between information, entropy, and segregation in cities. If you understand social segregation as a form of restricting interactions, we can imagine that urban structures can have a role in social segregation. So differences of entropy between urban areas may create the conditions for the clustering of different social groups. So that means that the information about where you are likely to live and who you are likely to see on the streets may be encoded in the various spaces around you. So the urban form might encode social distancing in its very structure. So how can we transition to an urban experience without segregation? That's a key question for the future of our cities, of course, especially because we can see that segregation is such a pervasive feature of our cities and societies. In fact, humans are very good at creating differences between ourselves and creating spaces that reproduce those differences. So this requires us to think about how our cities work to both separate people and put them together. And we need some steps to do that. The first step is to understand that segregation has many dimensions. One of them is very well known, the segregation of places for different people, like the poor live over here, the rich live over there. But one of those dimensions is not so well known. And it's a very dynamic dimension. It's about how socially different people move through space, where they go, how their networks of movement may overlap or not in urban space. So if we look into those networks, we can better understand how we can overcome segregation and understand how urban space may foster encounters between socially different people. I think here of the location of major public services and how they are connected with transport systems, how these systems can be articulated in order to increase accessibility and stimulate people's mobilities, so that the networks of movement of different people can actually converge in the same spaces, and socially different people may experience each other in those spaces. So we need to think of segregation in a dynamic way.
children really can connect better when they move and play, to understand and to nurture their curiosity and to team up with others. I really would love to see an education that allows children to understand why they care about everything, no, and what can they do about everything.
There are 17 sustainable development goals designed to, you know, equalize opportunity, really create the world that we all want to see created, which is equality for all. We only really have 10 more years to make a really big impact and change the world, because we've really borrowed it from our children and we've not done well. So we hopefully have time, and I hate to dwell in the space of anything negative, but you've really focused on the SDGs in the educational system and inspired so many children.
We have used the SDGs in a good way to translate them into play activities where children can connect with these very abstract issues through an education for sharing, which is a methodology that allows children to and their communities to use play to understand the SDGs, why they care, to understand why civic values are so important to achieve these SDGs, and also to build a very strong platform of social emotional skills that in the end will also make you a happier person. What we do is we play also with teachers and parents. We train teachers very specifically, and we make sure that we invite parents to play the sessions where the SDGs come alive. And we have a play, reflect, and take action framework so that everyone is invited to have fun, feel a sense of belonging, you know, have a healthy interaction, and then to stop and reflect, what is this? Why? What experience did I have during the game? And now what can I do with this experience?
At the UN, I work on youth engagement, but in the technology side of things. And we have a lot of youth now that are protesting, that are upset. And so it's such a pleasure to post a challenge and get them engaged on being part of the solution and engaging in a positive way where they can actually make change. We need to mentor kids. We need to mentor them all along the way, but not in a way that's teaching down to them. We need to empower them in different ways. And we need to actually show them that they can be part of the change that we need in the world.
We have to change the focus on the priorities, no, and really give value to what's valuable and to what really has a transcendental impact. Sure, empowering, having women empower themselves through lots of different channels is crucial. We wonder a lot, no? What will the jobs be like? How should we prepare our children and our youth? And it's fascinating because by definition the future is uncertain, but now it's more uncertain than ever before. And we really need to focus on how are we preparing our children to have the resilience, you know, and to be problem solvers and to have all different avenues of understanding a same issue from different perspectives, almost having like a prism where you can see the different lights and colors and really come up with more creative solutions, more out of the box solutions, not conventional ways of, okay, this is how we do a rigid education, right? So that's why we need so much to transform the way that we are educating, to unleash that creativity that exists, but that we don't necessarily keep on nurturing. We have been so privileged to work with 1.3 million children, teachers, parents in the past 13 years, and we've replicated our methodology in 8 countries so far. It's remarkable and very inspirational how these kids are doing initiatives non-stop in their communities, and also very inspirational to see that the teachers really have that sense of ownership of the kind of teachers that they can be and what it feels like to play, to teach and to learn and to really have a more integrated sense of community when using something that usually is overlooked, like, oh, but it's only play. It's so sweet and yeah, it's fun, but it's so powerful. And that's what we want to give as a gift to the teachers that honestly work so hard. They are my heroes. Teachers are my heroes, and they're anonymous heroes most of the times, but they really, we all have a teacher that left a very deep footprint in our lives. We can't only feel at ease by educating minds. We have to educate minds, but without educating the hearts, it's not gonna get where we dream of and where we need. It's not only a dream, it's also a need.
Cities are shaping the world. That's where the military power is. That's where the political power is. That's where the economic power is. That's where the scientific power is. The urbanites will define the future of nature. The urbanites will define the future of the countryside, of the food producing areas, through conscious political decisions or unconscious or maybe conscious market system by the what they decide to buy and how they decide to spend their money. And yet urbanites are the most ignorant of that group of humans, of their dependence on nature to survive. So we figured out from a pragmatic point of view that we had to make a natural history museum, but make it urbanocentric, for the reason that urbanites have to understand how cities work and how they depend on nature in order to move forward. I'm a wildlife biologist by formation, and I've worked mostly with birds communities and studying how disturbances in mountain and cloud forest affect bird communities. That's been my main line of research. And so when I started designing this museum is when I started looking at the city different. Like most biologists or field biologists, cities are something that I disliked and that I really thought was the antonym of nature. Cities use over 0.5% of the energy of the world. They create, again, over half of the greenhouse gases. And cities are the ones that attract and use and consume energy, metal resources, carbon resources. So cities are the drivers in many ways of this overconsumption. And remind you that changes in the world have to do not just with human population growth, which is important, but also, and more importantly, with overconsumption by rich countries, mostly. So we have large inequity, both within countries and between countries, and that unfortunately is increasing, and thus eroding democracy, both worldwide democracy, and also democracies within countries, which, by the way, is a major role of museums, strengthening democracy through an alternate way of education for citizens to make the best decisions. I see that museums have been evolving into these catalysts of change and linkage with communities, and leaving the ivory tower perspective that was more common before. In fact, there's a big debate right now in ICOM, in the International Council of Museums, about the new definition of museums. And there's no consensus, and they had to postpone the decision for more discussions. One of the major roles of museums is strengthening democracy. And that's maybe not a direct role, but an indirect role, but I think it's fundamental. And the way museums strengthen democracy is by, in essence, education without books, because it's a different way of learning. And so a role of the museum is creating these sensations that lead to emotions, that lead to feelings, that then people on their own, drive people on their own to search knowledge in different places, including the museum itself, which needs to offer it. Also, those first types of interactions have to be emotional to be important. Well, museums have been very, very badly affected by the pandemic. In a survey done by ICOM, by the International Council of Museums, one out of eight museums that had to close during COVID will not open. They will be unable to open due to the economy.
It is only 3 decades ago that multilateral organizations believed inequalities were good for business, for competitive markets, for development. It was not only an economic decision or rationale. It reflected a sort of sense of justice and equity. The same organizations 10 years later recognized that inequalities were linked to poverty and sustainable growth, and they hindered development and stalled progress. Despite all this, UN Habitat stated in a recent report that 75% of cities in the world grew more unequal economically in the last 20 years. However, the same study pointed out that these inequalities have to do with access to jobs, income, opportunities, assets, justice, resources. In sum, the opportunities that urban life creates. Recently, an inhabitant from Bogota told me, when you are poor, you are economically poor, you are socially poor, you are culturally poor, you are always poor. What we need is cities without inequalities. Less than 10 years ago, the World Economic Forum mentioned that inequality was a major threat to the world's stability. Stiglitz, in the same vein, mentioned that global unrest has won a massive root cause inequality. He was correct. Popular demonstrations in cities from France, Spain, India, Colombia, Bolivia, Lebanon, Iraq, you name many other countries, are always connected by an invisible threat, soaring inequalities. What we need is cities without continuous social explosion, cities whose streets are taken to enjoy public space. But inequalities don't happen by accident, they are created. And this has been seen in the COVID world, that exacerbated inequalities, but at the same time took inequalities. This crisis has strictly exposed the inequalities between population and places. It's not a secret that the urban poor are much more exposed to the virus than other socioeconomic groups. They are more likely to die from COVID-19. Despite all this, equity still remains on the fringe of the political development agenda. Inequality matters, and SDG's Goal 10 is a reminder of this. Studies, however, as important as they are, Stiglitz, Thomas Piketty, and others, all at country level, give a lot of prominence to education, taxation, redistributive policies, the protection of labor markets and workers, all which is important. However, this study from UN Habitat has shown that when a country reduces inequality or increases inequality, there is always something like 20, 30% of cities that go on opposite direction. This means that other elements are at play: geography, history, culture, local policies, local governance. We want cities without inequalities. But for that, we need a pathway of a just world, one that recreates new norms, social ethical pacts, that is based on an empathy revolution, and all this grounded in human rights. We need to define for the first time a framework of action for cities to fight inequalities, based on a public rationale, based on a different moral code, and a modern vision of human rights. Thank you.
La segunda sección de los Lightning Talks se titula Trust. ¿Por qué la confianza es importante para la planeación urbana?
Our first speaker is Tenzin Priyadarshi. He's the director of the Dalai Lama Center for Ethics at MIT. He'll ask the question, why do we need trust in our community? And what role does it play in today's society?
Tendremos también a María Salguero. Ella es la creadora del mapa de feminicidios en México. Y es quien se ha encargado de ponerle nombre a estas víctimas y a dimensionar el problema. Tenemos también al doctor Mario Silva, quien destaca los efectos del COVID en el transporte público en México, pero también las implicaciones positivas de los sistemas alternos de transporte público que han llegado para quedarse. Estará también Rodrigo Canales, quien nos comparte su experiencia para generar empatía entre policías y ciudadanos. Tendremos también a Gabriela de la Torre, quien hace un llamado a generar ciudades más incluyentes.
And our last speaker is Sandy Pentland, the professor from the MIT Media Lab Human Dynamics Group. He'll discuss data, surveillance, and sort of aspiring towards more privacy. He'll both discuss how this happens, what the data is used, propose new systems to take us forward.
I'm here today with Tenzin Priyadarshi, the director of the Center for Ethics here at MIT. So Tenzin, thank you for taking the time to be with us today.
Thank you for having me. It is a delight.
So I would like to start by getting your thoughts on how we might enable more resilient, equitable communities. But first, what does resilience mean to you?
Resilience, for me, firstly begins with a kind of mental pliancy. And one of the things that I deeply believe is that resilience is something that can be trained.
You say that you can learn resilience. How can an individual train to become more personally resilient? And how can a community learn to be more collectively resilient?
Create little experiments, little practices that allows us to experience more of the wholesome emotional states around joy, a sense of self-esteem, a sense of trust that leads to collaboration and so on. And the more the individuals are able to cultivate emotional resilience, it helps build, again, the capacity and the capability for communities and organizations to build emotional resilience.
We did a workshop a few weeks ago to explore the concept of resilient communities. And the consensus of most groups was that building trust was where we should start. What are your thoughts on how we can increase the level of trust in a community?
One thing is a given that the progress of civic society can only move as fast and steady as our ability to trust one another. One of the things that we have been seeing with design of certain social media platforms that it's doing quite contrary to the narrative that was driving it, you know? So the narrative that will bring the world closer, it will connect everybody and so on. And we are looking at polarization on steroids by virtue of social media platforms. Mm-hmm. And when we start designing technologies and interventions where it poses a threat to those civic institutions, it's not just disrupting it, but it's threatening it.
So you may be familiar with our CityScope platform, which is designed to enable a community to explore possibilities for a shared future. The premise is that when you bring people together so they can look each other in the eye, debate alternatives, get feedback related to those alternatives, it creates a far more effective and creative process than with online tools. Do you agree that we should prioritize these in-person interactions?
I do believe so. I think the face-to-face interactions or this notion of proximity, creates and strengthens empathy at a much higher level than we have been able to sort of foster in online communities, you know. And empathy with the sense that it creates empathy beyond echo chambers, beyond boundaries of race, religion, gender, and so on.
Okay, well, let's change the topic. The theme of our City Science Summit this year is the power of without. So what does that mean to you? probably nothing.
You know, as a Buddhist monk, there's this wonderful thing about, you know, the paradox of within and without.
Right? Oh, okay. Well, tell us a little bit about that.
I think, you know, for me, without implies a sense of freedom. We must begin to decrease our sense of traditional dependencies that we have had thus far, because either those dependencies were not healthy or they're not going to remain healthy for the well-being of society in the near and long-term future. But the sense of without also, implies firstly without boundaries. And so without can imply a lot of things, but for me, it's without boundaries, without biases, which is, I believe, pertinent to this project of flourishing of civic society. I think, you know, we are living in an unprecedented time where a lot of these traditional hierarchical models are becoming obsolete.
So Tenzin, do you have any concluding words for our City Science Network from around the world?
Well, firstly, I'm truly delighted to have this opportunity to share some thoughts, and I have been heartened by the work I've seen the City Science Lab and the group do over the years, and not thinking about design simply in a limited fashion, but thinking of building a more robust civic society and civic institutions by focusing on what's lacking in the interaction of human values and promoting that. And it's not just about the idea that cities are the future, but as we think about the future of cities themselves, you know, one is of course the whole spectrum of Internet of Things and connected smart cities, but there are deeper aspects of in this connectivity sense that we don't lose essence of human connectivity and to each other and to the institutions that we built. And so I look forward to all the wonderful ideas that will continue to emerge and be built upon by this wonderful group of people.
Well, thank you so much, Tenzin. It's been a great pleasure to get your thoughts on life, on ethics, in the context of cities, and I really appreciate the humanity of your ideas.
Bueno, pues yo estudié geofísica en el Instituto Politécnico Nacional, muy burris para las materias de sociales siempre, pero era muy buena para matemáticas. De hecho, no entraba a clases, sacaba 8, 9 o 10. Y las de física también. Pero ¿por qué digo esto? Porque pues a fin de cuentas, quienes estudian más el tema del feminicidio y estos temas, pues son sociólogos, antropólogos, y de repente que una chava con una formación matemática llegue a hablarles de feminicidios y a visualizarlos sobre mapas, fue lo que llamó la atención, ¿no? Yo era vendedora ambulante, bueno, vendía en la calle junto con mi mamá en el centro, pero de ahí sacaba dinero para irme a estudiar. Cuando empezamos a generar esa base de datos, ya me di cuenta que era mucho trabajo estadístico y matemático. Y esa es la parte que me empezó a gustar, porque dije, con estas simples categorías empezaba a encontrar patrones. Imagínate si lo hubiéramos extendido más. Es que ese es el problema de México, no hay datos de nada. Y los datos que hay son muy deficientes. ¿Ves que está creciendo el problema a nivel nacional? ¿Ves que no sé, que el Estado de México es el que se acaparaba toda la atención del tema? Pero tú decías, pues veo que en todo el país hay esta problemática. Entonces, ¿cómo les demuestras? Pues mapeándolo. Y fue que les dije, voy a mapearlos, pero aquí empecé a usar las visualizaciones de Google y de Usajiri también. Este trabajo le correspondería al Estado mexicano hacerlo. Le correspondería estarlo haciendo una oficina y no a una sola persona. Pero creo que es algo que a lo que nos acostumbramos, que la sociedad civil genera los datos para el gobierno. Porque a fin de cuentas en Guardia Nacional, en Fiscalía General de la República usan mi mapa y lo consultan. Pues trato de ir cargando datos diario, subo datos diario al mapa, pero de repente sí leo toda la prensa nacional. Leo todas las notas locales y ya veo cuántos casos de feminicidios hubo. Hay veces que no los leo, a veces ya me llegan a mi WhatsApp directo, ya ni necesito buscarlos. Y a veces me llegan hasta los informes policiales. Si tienes el respaldo de una institución, yo creo que podrías mejorarlo. Podrías hasta construir algoritmos mejor diseñados para tratar de mejorar la información, pero déjame decirte, a veces la información te viene deficiente y después el imparcial te reporta igual 10 asesinatos en una misma hoja y a veces otro medio ya no te reporta el mismo caso, igual en una lista de 10. Entonces digo, ¿cómo hará un algoritmo para discriminar todo eso y saber que ese mismo caso reportado en 3 medios de forma diferente corresponde al mismo? Y muchos cuando van a arrancar sus proyectos deciden arrancar desde la ley. Entonces, pues yo dije, yo no voy a arrancar desde la ley porque esta ley general de acceso sí te contempla la violencia comunitaria, pero no te contempla la violencia por crimen organizado. Porque veía que había muchos asesinatos que tenían el sello del crimen organizado y en un momento decía, pues estas no entran en feminicidio, no son feminicidios, pero creo que es importante documentar porque fueron asesinadas violentamente. Si me hubiera ido a irme estrictamente por la definición de feminicidio, hubiera dejado fuera a muchas mujeres. Es una ley que se quedó obsoleta. Me gustaría saber más sobre las mujeres involucradas en contexto de crimen organizado. Porque a pesar de los pocos datos, de la poca información que hay, de las mujeres asesinadas por el crimen organizado, desgraciadamente, los familiares de ellas no hablan a los medios, porque pueden ser asesinadas ellas o los familiares que sigan vivos de ellas. Entonces, pues nunca salen a dar una entrevista en medio, pero la poca información que hay de esas víctimas, hay muchas vulnerabilidades que atraviesan. Entonces, sí, creo que si el Estado logra subsanar esas vulnerabilidades, dándoles acceso a educación, a un empleo mejor remunerado, a que puedan acceder a un empleo calificado, pues le podrían arrebatar a estas mujeres al crimen organizado. Entonces, me gustaría investigar más sobre eso. Pues a veces es con lo que se te ocurra. Mira, hay unas que ponen listones en los árboles con las víctimas de mujeres asesinadas. Hay otras que han bordado. Bueno, las bordadoras son antes de que yo hiciera el mapa. Las que bordaban feminicidios. Entonces, pues es simplemente lo que quieran hacer que lo lleven a cabo. Así sean primero ellas solas o con unas amigas. Yo creo que lo pueden hacer. O sea, y empieza a hacer un cambio, ¿no?
La situación de COVID-19 nos ha planteado muchos retos de manera global, en general para los sistemas de movilidad, pero para particularmente aquellos en los que el número de personas que nos desplazamos pues implican una concentración y una permanencia con cierta temporalidad dentro de alguna unidad de transporte público, sea colectivo o sea masivo. En específico, el área metropolitana de Guadalajara pues se tuvo que enfrentar a la capacidad de resiliencia de su sistema en diferentes aplicaciones, En el caso del transporte masivo y del transporte público convencional, pues aumentar las medidas de higiene y a que la percepción de los usuarios y usuarias sobre los riesgos pues les llevaran tal vez a no utilizar estos medios de transporte y pues por consecuencia a tener que reforzar la forma en la que el tema de higiene y sanitización se hace a través de estos mecanismos. En el caso de la movilidad activa, una de las situaciones colaterales que encontramos fue que se incrementaron los viajes en el sistema de bicicleta pública por una razón muy sencilla: es el medio de desplazamiento más seguro, más resiliente, más económico y que el que ofrece pues mayores posibilidades de no tener un contagio. Ahora el reto que tenemos es justamente aumentar el uso del transporte público adaptándolo a las nuevas condiciones de normalidad, entendiendo que hay necesidades diferenciadas. Específicamente me refiero al caso del personal que atiende los espacios médicos públicos y privados, no solamente doctores, médicos, enfermeras o doctoras, sino también personal administrativo, personal de limpieza. Una de las consecuencias que ha tenido la situación de COVID ha sido la aparición de un programa justamente pensando en ofrecer desplazamientos seguros a estas personas que trabajan en hospitales, ya sea en el área médica directamente o en otras áreas que son importantes, que se llama Conexión Médica. Y lo que nos está enseñando la experiencia de la operación de Conexión Médica es que pues, este tipo de programas llegan para quedarse. La aparición de ciclovías emergentes, que son llamadas de esta forma porque se busca que la construcción de las mismas ocurra en un periodo muchísimo menor de tiempo al que ocurre en una ciclovía convencional, con la intención de que al paso de los meses, pues estas infraestructuras terminen de formalizarse ya como ciclovías temporales. Una de las apuestas más importantes tiene que ser mantener la oferta y el servicio de calidad, tanto para el transporte público colectivo como el público masivo. Hoy uno de los conflictos fuertes es que haya una transferencia de usuarios de transporte público o peatones o ciclistas hacia el uso de auto privado o el de la motocicleta, y nos parece que necesitamos justo reforzar los medios públicos, los medios no motorizados, pues para evitar continuar con estas tasas de crecimiento de parque vehicular, sobre todo en la región de América Latina, que nos han llevado justamente a condiciones de inmovilidad. Los aprendizajes que nos está dejando COVID-19 están centrados en dos grandes agendas. La primera, cómo reforzamos el uso del transporte público a pesar de la pandemia, incrementando los niveles de seguridad en el uso de unidades o vagones de transporte masivo o camiones convencionales en el transporte colectivo, puesto que tenemos experiencias derivadas de otras situaciones parecidas, como el caso de la influenza H1N1 hace poco más de una década, en donde se decreció el número de usuarios, tuvimos una caída en distintas ciudades del mundo y fue muy complicado recuperar estas personas que utilizaban al transporte público como una alternativa. Así que necesitamos justo reforzar las medidas de higiene y reforzar el mensaje de utilizar al transporte público como una alternativa. Por otro lado, tenemos el caso de la movilidad no motorizada, movilidad activa, incrementar el número de ciclovías en las ciudades para garantizar trayectos seguros y reforzar también las zonas peatonales y también los programas de bicicleta pública, puesto que la bicicleta nos ha demostrado ser el medio más resiliente, más seguro y más económico para movernos en las ciudades durante la pandemia COVID-19.
Trust in the police and in the governments they represent are at record lows. Citizens are calling not only for reform, but often for the downright abolition of policing institutions. Police officers, on the other hand, most of whom joined their forces from a genuine calling for service and to devote their lives to protecting and serving citizens, increasingly feel misunderstood, underappreciated, wrongly accused. Is there a path forward? History has taught us that a functioning democracy needs an effective, resilient, and trusted police, so that it rarely needs to use it. Where do we go from here? This is the question that, together with a team of young, talented, and committed researchers, we have been exploring over the last 4 years. We have analyzed hundreds of police organizations and their practices. We have documented reform processes in detail. We have interviewed hundreds of experts and police leaders, and we have conducted rigorous field experiments. From this experience, I can promise you that there is a path. There is a clear hope for change. Our work has taught us two main insights about police reform. The first is that we must stop thinking about police forces as a collection of individuals, and we must take them for the complex organizations that they are. In any organization, and especially in a chain of command, structural factors will dictate behavior to an enormous degree. For example, most police organizations evaluate their officers using crime statistics and the number of arrests that are made. When we decide to focus on crimes and arrests, we're going to build a set of practices around that, from which data we collect to how we collect and analyze it, to the equipment, procedures, and training that we think defines what it means to be a cop. This means that changing police behavior requires you to look at the organization as a whole and change not only specific practices, but rather collections of practices, processes, and organizational linkages that create coherent expectations. For example, if you train cops to behave in procedurally just ways, but you only reward them for arrests and reductions in violent crime, not surprisingly, cops are going to have to focus on arresting people rather than on building citizen trust. This is related to the second main insight. Every organization, explicitly or implicitly, serves a central customer. If you think about how police chiefs are named, who they typically report to, who typically determines whether they stay or go, it will not surprise you to hear that it is common for police forces to implicitly operate as if their local government was their main customer. Police forces become entirely focused on the most visible and politicized metrics of performance. Their entire focus is on crime, and therefore actual potential or apparent criminals, who are a very small minority of people, some of whom can be quite dangerous. But there is another way. We have found police forces that, for different reasons, have learned to genuinely and explicitly place citizens at the center of everything that they do. They focus on understanding how neighbors define and understand their local safety problems. They also learn that in order to do their job well, they need the trust of the neighbors, especially in marginalized communities. It is they who know what's happening. So they learn to establish genuinely collaborative working relationships with neighbors to jointly design strategies to target local problems. And they create a new contract where both sides are accountable for building public safety together. For this to work, it has to be reflected in routines, structures, training, and evaluation metrics. Ultimately, whom we choose for positions of leadership and the extent to which they walk the walk is a first step without which nothing else can happen. We also need to be willing to truly work with them. Police work is extremely difficult, but we have seen police agencies radically transform themselves when there is a fundamental reframing in the mission of the organization and who's at the center of it. The organization is conceived as a system of interconnected practices, culture, and values that all need to be in coherence. There is significant involvement from civic society in a constructive, collaborative approach, and there is political support from the top leadership to ensure change across political cycles. There are no quick fixes. You see, complex problems have simple, quick, easy to understand, wrong answers. So we have to be realistic, patient, persistent, and disciplined. We must follow evidence and not temporary emotion. Police forces should never tolerate police misconduct, and we should hold them accountable to that. But police officers should not be framed as the enemy either. Just as we should expect police forces to hold officers who engage in misconduct accountable, we must also have the backs of those who act in accordance to our shared values. We can only do this from a place of mutual respect and empathy. We can only do this by listening to and working with each other. We can only do this together.
Una de las discusiones, sobre todo en la literatura de las urbanistas feministas de América Latina, las geógrafas y las arquitectas, que han venido a plantear la manera en la que se han diseñado las ciudades pensadas únicamente en las necesidades de los hombres. Los hombres y las mujeres partimos del supuesto que experimentamos la ciudad de manera diferente. Parte del fundamento teórico que se ha planteado desde las universidades es justamente la división sexual del trabajo que ha fragmentado la vida productiva y la vida reproductiva. Eso ha hecho que las ciudades estén pensadas en función a la vida productiva. Entonces, estamos hablando que desde la forma conceptual y cómo se concibieron las ciudades, están pensadas bajo una lógica, uno, de la vida productiva, y eso implica de la vida económica, de la cual históricamente las mujeres han sido segregadas y excluidas. Estamos hablando que hay una ruptura muy fuerte en cómo se está concibiendo la planeación, y eso tiene un impacto muy grande en la vida de las mujeres, porque eso afecta la manera en la que están construidas las banquetas, los espacios públicos, como los parques, los sistemas de transporte, la manera en la que se decide qué tipo de camión o autobús se va a utilizar para cierto corredor. Los planeadores de la ciudad, desafortunadamente, han dejado de fuera la visión de las mujeres. No ha habido tampoco una apuesta por empezar a generar información que pueda permitirnos tener una radiografía de cuál es el comportamiento de las mujeres, niñas y jóvenes en la ciudad. Entonces, creo que eso es algo que el feminismo y sobre todo las urbanistas feministas han puesto al centro de la discusión, que es pensar y cambiar este modelo de ciudad productiva, capitalista, a un modelo de ciudad pensada en las necesidades de la vida cotidiana de las personas. Entonces, creo que la perspectiva de género, esta visión analítica para poder mirar cuáles son justamente esas desigualdades que persisten y se replican de manera sistemática y que se originan a raíz de una condición de género. Y también algo que a mí me gustaría resaltar es que la perspectiva de género se ha enfocado mucho en esta visión binaria de hombre-mujer, pero creo que también la apuesta de la planeación de las ciudades y este planteamiento y estos lentes de esta categoría analítica del género tiene que tener también otras variables analíticas, como es la interseccionalidad, y también creo que es importante empezar a incorporar todas las identidades disidentes que existen, todas las sexualidades disidentes que existen en la ciudad, para poder justamente incorporar todas las identidades que se ven plasmadas en la ciudad y que también nacen a la ciudad. Algo que a mí me gusta siempre resaltar mucho es que el cuerpo también es un territorio que habitamos y que a final de cuentas también es un territorio que interactúa con otros territorios y también interactúa con un territorio específico, que en este caso puede ser la ciudad y el espacio público visto desde esa manera. Y al momento de haber una exclusión y que el espacio público sea tan hostil para nuestro cuerpo y para nuestros territorios, creo que también de ahí partimos en tratar de pensar en ser una ciudad que puede incluir todas estas identidades pensadas desde las diferencias y desde la forma en la que se intercruzan todas estas diferencias en el cuerpo y en la identidad y en las disidencias también de género, ¿no? Entonces, creo que es algo muy importante pensar las ciudades y la planeación en función de garantizar y de proveer servicios públicos que permitan garantizar el acceso a servicios básicos como es la salud, como es la educación, como también es el derecho que tenemos a un aire y a una calidad del aire limpio, a un transporte seguro, a un espacio público donde las mujeres podamos sentirnos seguras al salir. Y creo que todas estas categorías analíticas, que también la perspectiva de género ha utilizado para poder analizar las desigualdades, no solo de las ciudades, sino también de la vida económica, de la vida política que ha excluido a las mujeres, creo que ayuda a ver desde una manera integral y puede ser una herramienta súper poderosa como el feminismo para poder replantear la planeación de las ciudades y justamente poder llegar a erradicar esta fragmentación que existe en la vida productiva y cotidiana. Creo que el feminismo y la perspectiva de género tienen herramientas importantes para poder cambiar la manera en la que hemos diseñado y sobre todo en la que vivimos la ciudad.
Connection Science is this research program that includes analytics for social good, things like the Sustainable Development Goals, and trust data is how do you build systems that protect privacy and give you measurements of the Sustainable Development Goals. So trust data actually builds prototype software, and Connection Science has a sister effort, which is doing the science needed to do that. So what we do is we build pre-standard software to help governments around the world and large companies to be able to handle their data in a way that protects privacy and is much more secure, much more transparent and accountable. And now we're doing the next generation, which includes blockchain and AI and IoT and all those sorts of things to try to help countries, companies, figure out what to do. So one of the things that's unique about connection science and trust data is that we're social scientists and statisticians and computer scientists. A signature project of ours is called Open Algorithms. So what this is a way of making sure that AI is applied to data in a way that it respects privacy, is interpretable, is auditable. And we build example software and develop new analytics methods that protect privacy and are far more secure than previous methods. So the thing that motivates the OPAL, Open Algorithms project, is that there's this explosion of data. There's data about everything, everywhere. And of course, that's important to be able to make cell phones work and payment systems and track infectious diseases and make the traffic run on time. But it's very scary, too. I started the discussion at Davos at the World Economic Forum to try and address this and figure out if there's a win-win-win solution. And that discussion, fortunately, turned into the European privacy law. So the privacy law gives people rights over their data. And now what we're doing within that framework is we're doing various projects to demonstrate the power of it, to drive adoption. So for instance, I'm on the board of the UN's Sustainable Development Global Partnership for Data. And through that, we're using this framework to try and map poverty, map inequality, map other things that are part of the Sustainable Development Goals around the world. So an overarching sort of vision of where we're going is something that I call the human strategy. And it's a question of where does AI and data and IoT and all of those things fit in the human framework? Because we'd like this to be a human society. And so it's incumbent on us in our generation to be able to guide this towards a human-centered solution. And so we have to deal with all the sort of moral questions and applications and think about how do we want to design our society to make use of these tools and yet remain human. And we say, well, why don't we just not do that? That would be a response to that. We're demonstrably not very good at talking about how do we address these global challenges. So we need better tools to do that. And, you know, who's going to do that? Well, we all have to do it. And that's something that we're focused on.
La tercera sección de los Lightning Talks se titula Together.
In this section, we have the Dean of the School of Architecture and Planning, Hashim Sarkis. He's also the curator of the 2021 Venice Biennale, which is titled How Will We Live Together? We'll start the section with Hashim, telling us why this theme is important and trying to understand how this theme can serve as a point for all of the work that we do as the City Science Network. After Hashim, we'll meet City Science researcher Gabriela Bílá. She'll tell us about the work that the MIT City Science team is doing to prepare for an exhibit at the Biennale. This exhibit includes the work and the experience of three women in three informal communities from around the world. Gabriela will tell us who they are, how their stories inform us, and what we can learn from them about leadership and about working together as a community. She'll also have a conversation with them that has happened after her initial recording and meeting of them to understand where they are now and how are they dealing with the COVID-19 pandemic.
Esperamos que disfruten esta sección y que estas pláticas sean inspiradoras para lograr una discusión productiva que nos ayude a lograr comunidades más incluyentes y resilientes.
Hashim Sarkis, an architect, dean of the MIT School of Architecture and Planning, and curator of the Venice Biennale. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Welcome to the fourth annual City Science Summit, this year hosted virtually at the University of Guadalajara. I'd like to talk, first of all, about the Biennale. So the theme is a question: how will we live in the future? Why did you frame it as a question?
I felt that keeping it as an open question is apt not just for the spirit of a Biennale, because a Biennale usually is a kind of survey of a condition or a question, asking where things are today and mapping it, bringing the answers together. We don't expect definitive answers. There is no single answer to the question of how will we live together. That belonged to ideologies past. If anything, today it's always being asked of everyone, every part of life, and it's always open.
One of the themes of our summit is resilience. And we're asking the question, how can we enable more resilient communities? So I wonder if you have thoughts on that.
In a way, it might mean, as others have described it, Kenneth Frampton, one of them, as being architecture's inherent anachronism. Mm-hmm. In other cases, it's about architecture's ability to be flexible to a range of possibilities. And then I would also extend that discussion to the city, mm-hmm. as being able to absorb mm-hmm. different possibilities of life within it. Mm-hmm. And what we're living today is a test of the resilience of every space. Mm. The house becoming offices,
yep.
the street becoming cafes, the alleyway becoming paced by social distancing.
Probably seen, as I have, a lot of speculation about the future of cities. This has exposed a lot of the fragilities of our systems and inequities, and we will find new ways to address this problem. I wonder where you come down on that.
In a way, we are living the city at its most vital, meaning an open-ended answer to the open-ended question, how will we live together, mm-hmm. including the possibility of demise. If I can just give you a simple example, after the Depression and the Second World War, there were growing debates in academia and in public media about the future of cities after the war. Mm-hmm. Some imagined that because of the car and the public transport, everybody will move out to the suburbs and it'll become the idyllic city. In a way, Frank Lloyd Wright's images of the city come to mind. And then there was this whole other movement about the urban renewal, about the need to renew mm-hmm. the core of the city and bring everybody together.
In the 60s in particular.
What happened after the war is that both options were played out mm-hmm. in the suburb and in the city centers. And their intersections produced different permutations and different identities of different cities.
The theme of this, of our City Science Summit in Guadalajara, is the power without. I'm wondering if you
see that kind of a future as being potentially positive for communities?
There's absolutely no question that questions of being off the grid have proven in certain settings to be very effective and powerful. Localization of certain resources, especially energy, makes transportation, which is a huge energy consumption dimension, much more viable, much more economically and sustainability-wise efficient. So if we take those factors in without equating them fully with the loss of governance or the loss of coordination mm-hmm. or the loss of equity, then I'm willing to go down that path.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you, Hashim. Very interesting, and I so look forward to seeing the Biennale May 2021 now.
Yes. May 22, 2021. Saturday will be the official opening, but the pre-parties, which are the more important events, meaning the fun part, are the few days before.
Perfect. I'll be there. Thank you.
Hashim invited our group to present our works about informality in the Biennale. And we wanted to present it in a way that would be this overlap between an artistic experience, but also based on data, which is traditionally what our group does. We went on a path to make an immersive documentary about three very diverse places in the world that our group currently has collaborations going on: Cairo in Egypt, Port Harcourt in Nigeria, and Guadalajara in Mexico. One of the lines of research that always I related a lot is the cityscope, and especially this idea that a big white Lego model, like a complete abstraction of cities, can create a field to people imagine and wonder the future of cities and discuss. Why not take this symbolism of the table and people around the table and look at the table as a way to understand the cities? Literally, like, look what is on the table of the people in the cities, and what is the food culture there? What is what they eat? And from observing these meals, like, try to understand what forces drive people in the cities. I would document meals in the cities, connecting with one family in each city, and within that family get more closely to the person who is responsible for the food decisions there. And naturally, this became a work about women. The first woman I met was Eva, La Barbie del Sentinela in Lomas de Sentinela in Mexico. She is a big leader in the community, and she used to be even the president there for a while. Everybody knows Eva. And I was there in December to document her Christmas and the saga to get the tamales, ingredients, the pozoles, the piñata. The second woman I met was Mama G. She is a central figure in the flyover market. It's this big market underneath a highway in Port Harcourt. And she's there for many years, and she's very trusted by everyone. And she's the head of this little collective banking system there that they created. And also she sells her potions there.
Lemongrass for body pain. Bitter root for belly, manpower all over the body, garlic for chest.
While I was still in Mexico, I learned that Mama G's husband passed away. And in Nigeria, the rituals of a funeral is very different from what we have here. It's a public event, and it requires a lot of investment from the family. We agreed to support Mama G's husband's funeral, and we would document it. Yeah, so there I went to meet the Chicoco film crew, and we would document Mama G in the funeral.
Rest in peace,
The third woman I met was Jihane. She is working in the Dawar kitchen in Cairo, and she also has the dream to sing. She is a divorced mother, something that is not very common in a Muslim society. And this can tell a little bit like how brave this woman is. Cairo was the most difficult city to film and to also get connected to a woman there. It's basically in a dictatorship. While I was planning the trip, there would be the anniversary of the revolution, and there was police all over the place. It was difficult to find a film crew to film with me there, because like everybody was super skeptical about having cameras on the streets. People were afraid to get arrested for that. But the thing is, Cairo, the same way as the Red City is like this rough, sterile walls of bricks outside, when you go inside the houses, everything is so colorful and full of textures and tapestry. That's the same thing. When you get to know the people there, when you connect to people, when you manage to enter the life that is going there, it's like so warm and people are amazing. So all the filming happened between December and February, and then I came here back to MIT, and 1 week later we were all sent home for the lockdown. And had I waited one more second to go, this wouldn't have happened. Like it wouldn't be possible to travel and document these countries.
Hello. Wow.
How are you?
Hi. Nice to see you too. How's everything?
Ay, por fin, se apagaba, se prendía, se apagaba.
Mira.
Ah, la pulserita.
Las cosas están abiertas o están cerradas.
I'm just returning from my business.
Wow, it's so pretty.
No, se ha abierto todo. Todo normal. Te digo que aquí no ha venido, es más, no ha venido nadie a visitarnos. Te mira.
We stopped working for a while during the lockdown. People left. Actually, Jihane left the kitchen. So yeah, and we are getting back to business steadily and slowly.
¿Qué es la mejor diferencia de la comunidad antes de la pandemia y ahora?
Plena pandemia, nos quitan el agua. Estaban el gobernador y todos que, ay, báñense y cuídense y lávense las manos. Le digo, sí, ¿con qué nos las vamos a lavar? ¿Con pipí o qué? Entonces, por eso fui a manifestarme con toda la gente y fuimos ahí a Tabachines y Periférico.
¡Queremos agua! ¡Queremos agua! ¡Queremos agua! ¡Queremos agua!
They wear the mask all, most of the time, not just while cooking. We maintain physical distance between each other. Unfortunately, we stopped this meal gathering every morning around the table. So, yeah, because that was the best part of the day, you know.
During the lockdown, we used to go market 2 a.m. or midnight and bought small things and run come back. We could bribe police before it passed to the market. We carry torchlights. They locked people, a lot of people. The big market did not open. They just opened it 2 weeks ago. Women suffer.
¿Te preocupas del corona? ¿Tienes miedo de infectarte?
No, I was very healthy. God is taking good care of us.
Yo soy bien valiente. Yo no le tengo miedo a nada. Pero yo siento que esto del coronavirus, no, yo siento que es un fraude, que es algo que inventaron.
We are not as worried as with the first wave because it will be familiar now. We will know how to handle it.
¿Qué te piensas del futuro de su vida?
This series of events made me realize that, you know, Cairo is full of this life force, strong and overwhelming. I'm grateful that we are surviving so far and we get back to normal very soon. Yeah.
My future, my own future, I'm happy, is very bright because we have God in our side.
Le pido a Dios siempre mucha sabiduría y fortaleza porque yo sí quiero pues ver mi colonia cambiada y mi colonia que mejore. Si no hay comunidad, no puedes mejorar.
Is there anything you want to tell?
I'm looking for money.
Thank you, Mama G. Good night.
God bless you. Good night.
Keep in touch. Bye-bye.
Bye.
This concludes the main stage program for The Power of Without. In my introduction, I mentioned the value that we place on multidisciplinary or anti-disciplinary approaches to problem solving. We believe that it is essential to connect people with broadly diverse experiences and skills if we are to address the complex social and environmental problems of our era. We believe in integrating innovative approaches to design, to public policy, to technology, if we are to meet these challenges. I think it is fair to say that the program of the last 2 hours brought together one of the most diverse group of speakers ever assembled. We heard from world-class architects about the role of design and infrastructure in creating a better future. We heard from politicians who are making decisions every day that impact the lives of the people that they serve. We heard from educators about the future of learning, from scientists developing technology that may be in our future, from an activist, a feminist, an artist, and even a Buddhist monk. And finally, we met three women who live in communities whose voices are almost never heard. These short talks were intended to be a high-level introduction to the ideas and possibilities that we all collectively care about. The workshops planned for the next 3 days will enable a much more detailed exploration of many of these ideas. It is a chance for your voice to be heard, so we welcome your participation.
I want to thank Maggie Church, Myra Gamboa, the MIT City Science Group, and the University of Guadalajara, as well as our international network of city science researchers, for the effort and passion that they all brought to the task of putting together this virtual event. And thanks to all of you for joining us.
So thank you all for attending the fourth annual City Science Summit, The Power of Without. So it was a summit without co-location and a great opportunity to experiment with putting together a virtual meeting. I want to thank Maggie, who led the effort here at MIT, and Myra, that did an amazing job pulling it together in Guadalajara. So Myra.
Gracias. Estamos muy contentos de recibirlos en Guadalajara. Para nosotros esta es una gran oportunidad para compartir ideas, pensar en nuevas soluciones para enfrentar los retos que nos esperan en el futuro para estas ciudades. Gracias y nos vemos mañana.
Thank you, everyone. It was an honor to work with you, and we look forward to much more with you, our team in Guadalajara.
Espero que hayan disfrutado este primer día. El Summit, por supuesto, nos hubiera gustado tenerlas y tenerlos físicamente. Esperemos que la primera oportunidad lo puedan hacer. Y nos vemos mañana en el segundo y también muy intenso día de este estupendo evento.
Thank you for joining the first day of the City Science Summit. Nos vemos mañana.
Muchas gracias. Ha sido un honor estar con ustedes y asistiéndolos y participando en el Summit. Y pues nos estaremos viendo en más... Los demás. Buen día.
Hope you enjoyed today y nos vemos los siguientes días y que lo disfruten mucho.
Gracias por acompañarnos. Espero que lleguen muchas ideas de valor.
Thank you to all our panelists and participants. It's been a pleasure learning from you today.
Hola, gracias por acompañarnos. Ha sido una gran experiencia. Esperamos que sigan disfrutando lo que queda de este Summit y nos vemos mañana en la Happy Hour también. Bye.
Ha sido un placer haberlos asistido y esperamos verlos muy pronto, ya sea en la Happy Hour o en las sesiones futuras. Hasta luego.
Gracias por ser parte. Enjoy.
Un placer haber pasado este día con vosotros y creo que estos tres días juntos van a ser muy emocionantes. Nos vemos en la Happy Hour. See you in the Happy Hour.
¿Qué tal? Gracias por acompañarnos en este primer día, por este reto juntos a la distancia y nos seguimos viendo los siguientes días. Hasta luego.
Thanks, everyone. Bye. See you soon.
Nos vemos. Gracias.
Gracias.
Gracias.